So, hello, good morning, everybody, to our fifth Job to be Done webinar. We will cover the principles, the basic understanding of jobs to be done thinking, and the outcome-driven innovation process. And today we have a special topic on the plate. It is on how to identify quick wins and get short-term results out of the innovation process, as this is really a call to action at the moment in our industry and in I would say in the whole world, that innovators are really challenged at the moment. Now, let us have a look at the agenda. We will start off with short guiding questions. We will then have a discussion on what market opportunities are and what unmet needs are and how to find them. We will briefly cover what jobs to be done is and how it helps us to generate opportunities and to understand opportunities with the process of outcome-driven innovation. I will drop in a number of examples of real quick wins and short-term results that companies have generated in applying that framework. And I'm then also happy for a short Q&A session at the end of the webinar that will run up until 9:30 today. So you may also drop in your questions into the chat, and I will pick up your comments in the chat then later on in the Q&A. Now, actually, it boils down to two guiding questions: how to increase revenue and how to reduce cost. Ultimately, as you are innovators, you will probably reframe this a little bit and frame it like how to increase value for the customer and how to reduce burden or how to reduce cost for the customer who takes on your products and services. Ultimately, what this will generate or shall generate is that you can increase market share, probably increase prices for improved and new products, improve customer acquisition, increase, yes, the word profitability, reduce product cost, and so on. A lot of stuff that innovators are challenged with. Now, keep in mind, it's about creating value, and it's about creating value for your customers, for the people outside there. Now, if you want to answer these questions, these two guiding questions, there's one thing that we really have to know in advance. What opportunities exist for value creation in the market, and what are the unmet needs? Now, to start with that, what are the unmet needs? We have some quotes here from really well-known entrepreneurs and very successful people. Henry Ford quoted that if I had to ask people what they wanted, they would have said faster horses. Now, based on this quote, one would understand that yes, customers don't know what they actually want, customers cannot articulate their needs, and customers have latent needs, needs they don't know they have. You know this discussion in the innovator space about latent needs and how difficult that makes to really come up with innovation, with successful innovations. Another quote from Steve Jobs tells us that people don't know what they want until you show it to them. Again, the same three basic insights here are customers don't know what they want, they cannot articulate their needs, and they have latent needs. And in our point of view, these are three deep-rooted myths or beliefs that cause companies to fail at innovation. These three points: customers don't know what they want, can't articulate their needs, and have latent needs. Because if you really believe in that, and if that is the case, yes, if people don't know and can't articulate their needs, then why talk to them? And if that is the case, how can we at all understand needs before we innovate? This is a big dilemma, and it's a lot of discussions also in literature going on towards how to really understand unmet needs. Now, we could reframe this a little bit And what if we would frame it like this, that Henry Ford, Steve Jobs and others, what they are saying is that, yes, customers don't know what solutions they want. Customers cannot articulate the best solutions to them. And customers have latent solutions, if you like, solutions they can't conceptualize. Solution is not a need. A solution is not a need. A solution ultimately satisfies underlying needs. So if you frame it like this, probably this will bring us on a new track here. So asking people what solutions they want is a failed approach to innovation. So let's ask customers about their needs instead. And what happens then? Okay, I have lost my slides here. I'm back on track again here. So let's ask customers about their needs instead. And what exactly is a need? Now, what is a need? How can we understand and find needs? We see that even experts on customer insight and innovation experts do not really agree on what a need is. And here we have the result of 12 experts that we have been talking to about what a need statement is and how it is defined. And you can see it's anything like assumptions of what a product should do, what a customer wants a product to do, and so on, the full list of points here. Now, if even experts on customer insights do not agree on what a need is, it's even more complicated for everybody out there who wants to innovate, not exactly knowing how to start with. So we could summarize here that the problem with innovation is not that customers don't know their needs. Probably the problem is that companies don't know what a need is and how to ask and how to identify those needs. A need ultimately should be structured in a way, or should instruct the organization how to successfully create customer value. So this is really what a need must deliver. It must inform us on how to create value. A key to that was found in Jobs to be done theory, quoted by Clayton Christensen and also by Tony Alvick, who then also created the outcome-driven innovation process. Now, people don't want a quarter-inch drill, they want a quarter-inch hole. So this summarizes it really in a nutshell. The hole is the underlying need, and the solution is probably a quarter-inch drill, but probably you can also use other solutions to get this ultimate job done. Now, this can be really start to be a lengthy discussion on how to frame a job, what is a job, and I will give you some examples later on here in the webinar. Now, this job theory puts a new lens on innovation. The new lens means that we understand that people buy products and services just to get jobs done. That's the only reason why people buy a product or a service. And if you make this job the unit of analysis, we are able to define markets, needs, opportunities, even segments and strategy through such a jobs to be done lens. And I will give you some examples now on how this can work and how this can help to really generate quick wins on the questions that we have raised in the beginning. It all builds on some publications. Really, a recommended book is What Customers Want from 2005 already, where Tony Alvick laid out this way of thinking on how to break down jobs to be done theory into a very structured innovation and strategy process. And there's also a book on jobs to be done in practice, which also catches up on it and explains how to actually do it in practice. So you can see this summary as kind of an initial summary of those books. Now let us start with a real example. What you can see here is, what is that? Is that a need or is that a solution? as a first question. And this is a good guiding question for everything you deal with as an innovator. What you have in front of you, is that a solution or is that a need? And the question should be here, if that is a, obviously a solution, it's a product, what is the underlying job to be done? So what is the job to be done? For those who are not out of this space of medical devices, this is a catheter. That's something that you can use to, you know, put it into your arm and then get some medication. Now, this is already a keyword. Ask yourself on what a product is doing. Ask yourself in what situation a certain product is being used. And this will give you a good understanding on what the underlying job might be that the job executor wants to get done. In that very example here, it is that nurses want to administer a medication. Now, imagine you are in the business of these catheters and you would put it from the job perspective, from a product perspective, you would say, I'm in the catheter business and trying to get quick wins, trying to generate more value with catheters. But if you reframe that in to the job perspective, then you would say, hey, I'm in the business of administering a medication. And how can I help people get this job done better? How can I help nurses administer medication much better? And this then leads you to a new track on how to find new value opportunities. Once we have understood what the job to be done is, it's becoming very, very interesting because now we can break down this job into its components. We call that a job map. And the beauty of this job map is that it describes a job like administering medication in its ideal way. So what we have here is not a customer journey. It is a description of a job as a process in its ideal way. So we want to understand what people really want to achieve in each step of their job, in this case, administering medication, and how they measure their success when doing it. And the success measures are the outcomes. And we want to understand for each step of that job. First of all, we want to understand the structure of the job steps, and then, of course, the desired outcomes that people want to achieve when running through such a job. So customer needs in that perspective are approximately 100 plus metrics that customers use to measure success when executing a job to be done. And we call them the customer's desired outcomes, therefore outcome-driven innovation. Now, there are actually three ways to get a job done better and three ways to measure success in getting a job done. These ways, these parameters are very functional and measurable. It's people want to get the job done faster in every step of a job. People want to get the job done more predictable. This means with less variability and less errors. And they want to achieve a higher output or throughput when getting a job done. So minimizing the time it takes to get it done, minimizing the likelihood that something goes wrong, and minimize the likelihood of something limiting your efficiency and your throughput when executing such a functional job to be done. Now, let's have a look at this example of the nurses that want to administer medication. If you break down that job in its ideal structure, we would find this kind of 8 steps here, where the job somewhere begins at determining the need for a therapy, determining the medication administration plan, setting up everything, setting up the equipment, establishing a venous access, so to get an access to a vein. And that's actually the job step where you probably need to have that catheter, because that's exactly the function of the catheter to give you this access to the vein. But here we don't describe it as a product, we describe it as a job step. Then the execution takes place, medication is administered, and so on. There's a monitoring step inside. Now, what are the outcomes? How do people measure success in getting this job done? And one example here is that, yeah, minimizing the time it takes, minimizing the likelihood. In this case, they want to minimize the likelihood that multiple approaches are needed to access a vein. For example, needle sticks, pinches, etc. Everybody of you who had ever this situation to receive such a catheter will know that from own experience. You don't want them to reapproach you and to have several tries up until this venous access works. So minimizing the likelihood that multiple approaches are needed. Now, this is very much measurable. It's very clear what they want to achieve, and there's no solution mentioned and no feature mentioned in that, and no service mentioned. So that is a need statement that is actionable, and it's valid over time. So this need statement will be true, was true for the past 50 years, and probably will be true for the next 50 years. What will change is only the solutions and the processes on how to achieve this, these outcomes, because technology will change and is changing. And you as an innovator, you wanna create those solutions and focus on the unmet need first. Now, another example of such a desired outcome is to minimize the likelihood that an access device comes out of the vein when the patient moves. Again, you can see this is a very clear-cut statement. It's pretty much free of interpretation, and everybody will understand that statement, even if you are not directly out of that industry. That's also another important fact to formulate needs and outcomes. They should be formulated in very plain language and understandable for everybody, even if those people are not out of that specific solution space. Because then you can integrate and activate innovators from all over, all around the world, so to say, also from other areas, to bring in their expert viewpoints in solving such needs. Actually, you will have more than 100 such statements when you run through this process and challenge job executors really on where do you lose time, what things can go wrong, where do you have extra efforts. They will tell you in their own words, and what you will then do is that you translate these quotes into such outcome statements together with the job executors to really be sure that you capture it the right way. How to do this, we will cover in another format in the Job to Be Done masterclasses that are upcoming also, and I will not go too much into detail on this now. Now, what is an opportunity? Actually, an opportunity is an unmet need, and it means it is a desired outcome that is either underserved or overserved. And what that means, we will see now in a picture. We call that the opportunity landscape. And during the opportunity discovery step, opportunities for innovation are quantified through a large-scale survey to identify these needs and which of these needs are under or overserved. This means you put a questionnaire with about these 100 outcome statements out to your target group and kindly ask them to give you two valuations for each statement, for each of their needs. First of all, how important it is and how relevant, and second, how they are satisfied in getting it done. Now, if you put that in place, you will end up with such an opportunity landscape where you have a lot of dots inside. Each dot is a need. Each dot is an outcome, a desired outcome statement that has been evaluated by all the job executors that you have been asking. So this is the total market viewpoint on needs and how well they are how well they are served and how important they are. Now, if we look at this a little bit closer, we see basically three areas. The dark gray one is underserved. These are needs that are extremely important, not very well served. And just to give you an example, one of these dots could be this outcome statement from before, like minimize the likelihood that an access device comes out of the vein when the patient moves. So in that case, it would have been identified an opportunity in the total market where the majority of people tell us that this is extremely important, but not very well served with existing solutions. So underserved needs would guide measures to generate additional value by coming up with better performance, by creating better services, better products that measurably address these underserved needs. On the other hand, we have overserved needs as well. Those are needs that are not so important, but very well served with existing solutions. What to do with them? Rechecking. We could recheck here if we could change our solutions, change our services in a, I would say, disruptive manner to reduce performance on these needs, to get down with cost, to get down with efforts, and reduce performance as those needs are actually overserved. So also an overserved need bears an opportunity, and ultimately speaking, these are opportunities for disruption. So here you can find cost-saving potential in your products and services. And putting all that together means a product or service strategy could be looking at reducing performance and overserved needs and increasing performance on other served needs. Now, there's a third element here that's table stakes. Those are needs that are extremely important and already very well served. So they are more or less okay and very sensible. You should be careful if you create new products or services not to change satisfaction scores on these table stakes, as they are super important and already very well served. Again, we can have a lengthy discussion on the opportunity landscape and how they can further be drilled down in another format and in another discussion or as a follow-up to the webinar. Now, when we have this data in place, we have actually a data model in place, a needs model in place. We know all the needs related to this job to be done. We know how they are scored by our target group, our job executors, and now we can really build upon this information. I would like to just briefly share this this table here, as it really gets down to facts and measures that you can work on in your team. Now, you will have a list of opportunities here, all the needs that you found, and they are in a rank order according to the opportunity score. So the opportunity score is a very simple calculation based on importance and satisfaction. The higher the importance, the lower the satisfaction, the higher the opportunity score, vice versa. And now we know what the opportunities are in the market. So we have resolved that. We have come up with an insight on what the opportunities are. And now we can have a discussion on several things. And I would like to highlight the red points here. They are really capable to deliver quick wins for you. We should bring in the question, how should we position our existing products and services towards those opportunities for innovation? You will most probably find some benefits that your products already have that address certain opportunities in the market, but obviously customers don't know about that. And that could really help then to refocus and reshape communication strategies and come up with explanations and examples to customers on how they can benefit from your existing products and solutions and services towards the most relevant unmet needs. Having said that, you will also want to discuss then ways to improve your existing products, probably with add-ons, with some features that can be done very fast and very quickly that can be added on to a product or a service to also give you a quick win result. And once you are in the discussion, it's good to keep on going and also answer question 4 and 5, which would be a little bit more long-term perspective, because when you realize that it's not possible to really capture and cover an opportunity fully with just better communications or improvements or add-ons, you will probably want to consider to come up with new offerings that fill gaps in your existing product and service portfolio. And having said that, if you discuss your portfolio, you might find products that you could skip as they are overperforming or as they are not necessary from a customer's point of view to get the job done perfectly. And this again will save you some effort and time and money. The fifth question is really a long-term one. What the long-term strategy should be pursued to get the entire job done? That means a solution approach, a solution platform that addresses all of the important opportunities in one single solution platform. And you will want to recheck where you are in that process already. You may want to come up with a longer term roadmap to achieve that. So this is then really the long-term perspective. But let us stick with short-term and quick wins for the moment. Now, here are some quick wins and short-term results. And we have been structuring this discussion into two dimensions. One is reducing costs and increasing revenue. And the other one is really who is doing that, who is responsible for it. And this can be the product management and development. And on the other hand, it can be marketing and sales. So these are the two areas that are super innovation related in an organization, and who can here come up with ways to find quick wins. And I would like to give you some examples on this now. Let us start with the first quadrant in our metrics, reprioritizing innovation portfolio to speed up time to market. It's about reducing cost, reducing efforts, reducing energy, freeing up resources in product management and development, R&D. Now, how does this example look like? We are talking about a machinery producer here, producing such wheel loaders, as you can see it on the picture. And yes, ultimately, if this manufacturer would look at their market, again, they would have the insight that the wheel loader is the solution, is the product, but what is the underlying need? Moving material on a construction site. And if you deep dive on that job to be done, you find a bunch of outcomes, desired outcomes, that are still not covered with existing solutions. And here you can then, of course, have a lengthy discussion on how to optimize your solutions, how to innovate solutions in the long term, but also how to gain quick wins. And one of these quick wins here was to really strengthen the product portfolio. So the product range in that case was reduced from 6 to 5 types with segment-specific positioning. So there were also this manufacturer also found that there are different segments of customers with different types of needs. And you can then have a discussion on how to reduce such overlaps in the product portfolio. And this, of course, then will free up resources and boost your time to market to also be faster on the market. Now, another example on product management and development and how to support increasing revenues is finding quick add-ons to products and services that customers also value. And here we have an example from a circular saw producer, tool manufacturer. It's Bosch, it's the Bosch case. Now, what they did is they found out that ultimately people want to cut wood in a straight line. And if you look at the market from that angle, you will also find a lot of stuff that is related to the existing products and things that are not really related to the existing products. This will open a big innovation roadmap for such a manufacturer. In this case, Bosch did not want to come up with a radical innovation, but to optimize their product for a new geographical market that they wanted to enter. So the take was the product must not become more expensive. they even wanted to reduce cost, product cost here. But on the other hand, they wanted to get really a USP in the market compared to all existing competitors. And the solution was to just change certain features on that existing product to address important desired outcomes from the viewpoint of the tradesmen, of the workers on the construction sites. And here is an example that also plays into what's happening then with design approaches, concept development approaches. The teams get in here and had a look at the opportunities. I will share here two opportunities with you. You can see them on the slide here. One opportunity from the workers on the construction site was that they want to minimize the likelihood that debris gets in the face when watching the blade track the line. So when they cut wood in a straight line, they want to minimize the likelihood that debris gets in their face. And on the other hand, they also wanted to minimize the likelihood of inadvertently moving off the cut line or the cut path when the cut line was covered with dust. Everybody who ever used a saw on your own may really capture that from own experience. And I think it's also, it's understandable when you look at that product that this is could be one of the outcomes that people have. Interestingly, this was an extremely high opportunity, extremely important and not very well served with existing solutions. So what Bosch did is they just changed a little bit the design of that saw so that they had the airflow redone in that tool. And the airflow that comes out of the saw while it is working and running then blows away the dust from the cut line and also from the face, so it cannot come into the face of the worker. So this was a very, very simple solution. You would say not rocket science at all. And actually, this was done within just 3 hours of creativity work. All of the features that you saw here, that you see here, we also have a case study on that and we're happy to share it. So this also helps you to understand that even creativity processes and design processes will really be speeded up if they are fed with these clear-cut statements on what the need, what the problem really is. Okay, let's move on to another type of quick win that you may generate out of these insights on opportunities. It's on marketing and sales and measures that these teams need to come up with and how to reduce effort, how to reduce cost there in finding cost-saving potential in marketing and sales efforts. Now, here we have a case. That's a company called Arm & Hammer. What they do is animal nutrition, and they had several market launches that really failed. So it was really an issue on how to nail things down, how to come up with the right messaging, how to come up with the right positioning, and saving cost on market launch efforts that ultimately did not generate successes. So based on the understanding of the real needs and the match between their solutions and the needs that the customers had, they were able to really cut down on efforts in marketing communications by really focusing on those few arguments and few messages that really made the difference. And they could grow their nutrition business year on year with 30% increase the revenue. So yes, we can see cost saving on the one hand and increasing revenue on the other hand. Another example, and this is now the final take, so to say, would be a quick win just by changing communications, really just by changing communications and communicating unique customer value to boost sales. And here is a case from medical device industry to pick up this medical example again. Here is a company called Coloplast, and what they do is they are specialized in wound healing solutions. So this kind of plasters and stuff and devices that help medical professionals to support wounds to heal. And there was a big insight that was generated here, while the industry was up until then communicating on how fast their products help to heal a wound. And all the competitors, you know, like, were using arguments on how fast their products work and how fast you get a wound healed. We realized, and they realized, that the big issue and the big opportunity was not to get a fast healing wound, but to reduce the likelihood of complications in the healing process. So that's probably, from a technical viewpoint, pretty much similar. Not totally, but from a communication viewpoint, it's really similar, because making fast healing is a different thing than reducing complications, even if it takes longer to heal. But if you know that there will not be any complications in that process, that's a bigger take, and that's a bigger value for customers. And the result was that this company, Coloplast, could generate a double-digit growth within 6 months in a certain product area, just by repositioning that one. Another effect, of course, and then we go ahead for the long-term effect, was to reposition the whole company towards this new value proposition, and then also, step by step, change the focus in R&D, change the focus in product management toward this new focus on the real opportunities in the market. Now, these were some examples on how to really generate quick wins an understanding of the real opportunities. And let us summarize like this: knowing what customers value shall guide value creation, and not only short-term, but also long-term. And if you want to reframe the initial questions, like increasing revenue and reducing cost, let's reframe it to addressing underserved needs, creating more value for customers on the one hand, which will ultimately then also generate revenues for a company, and on the other hand, reducing efforts on overserved needs, reducing efforts from an organization, from your teams, to address needs that are already overserved, and then reducing cost for the customers in their products and reducing product cost. Now, this would be, an innovator's viewpoint on generating quick wins on revenue and cost. And I would be very happy to see your questions and probably to have a short discussion on that. We are pretty well in time. I have a look at the chat here. I cannot see anything in the chat now. Okay. So if something pops up in your mind, just put it into the chat window. Another possibility is that you just give us the question in an email. You will get a follow-up email after this webinar, and just answer to that and give us a question if you have one. I would like to then also give you an outlook on the next things that happening here on our end. There will be a Job to be Done virtual masterclass in September 16 and 17, where we have a special topic of, again, it will be about how to prioritize your innovation pipeline based on customer needs and how to minimize R&D risk. And we will start off with a similar approach to the framework, but then highlight different application of it towards minimizing R&D risk and setting up a future pipeline for growth, also covering digitalization topics in that masterclass. Be informed It is called a masterclass basic, which means it is a shorter setting, timely wise. It will be 2 half days, while there will be a masterclass advanced, and that will be more time involved. It's 3 half days in that. And here, this will happen in October. We have a real innovator on board who will share their story. It's Marco De Polo from Roche Diabetes Care. And he will explain to us how they have learned to strategically align the efforts of product management, R&D, marketing, and sales with customer needs. He will give us an introduction into how Roche Diabetes Care really implemented the full framework from strategy creation down to design sprints and concept development, down to sales and go-to-market communications, all using an aligned understanding of the same single type of opportunities. You may go for the Masterclass Basic and then go for the Masterclass Advanced, or directly jump into the Masterclass Advanced. The difference here is in the Masterclass Advanced is you get the same type of basic introductory, but then more input on the application of it. So that's the difference between these two formats. Now, I see some questions coming in. Great. We still have 15 minutes to go, and I will use that, make use of that time here. Okay, here I see something. Do you have software examples? Yes, we have. You know Microsoft OneNote, the note-taking software from Microsoft, that was created based on such a project, jobs to be done and outcome-driven innovation. And a lot of software, namely from Microsoft, but also from other software producers, are using that framework. We did more than 40 projects, I think, only with Microsoft on software development. We also have case studies on startups that really scaled up based on these insights very fast. And I'm happy also to share such case studies with you in the follow-up. Now, job to be done looks very simple. Do you think it is also useful for startups? And does it make sense? Definitely. I think especially startups have great ideas and great solution ideas in mind. They have a lot of capability. And I think the big challenge for startups is to really canalize and focus that energy that is there to get it right the first time. So what we want to avoid with all of that kind of insights is we want to avoid approaches where you have to iterate very, very often. So we want to cut down on these iteration steps and iteration phases by just getting it right the first time, by starting with the right opportunity right away, which will then generate less effort for prototyping, less effort for testing, for building, help you to get to market faster. And there are also examples for such startups that I already said that we can happily share. I see another question here. The framework seems very good for incremental and adjacent innovation. How do you see the framework in disruptive, not just low-cost product in overserved market, but also ecosystem innovation? Great question. Thank you very much for that. That is a second line of application of this framework. In this webinar now, I really covered the application on quick wins, mainly on core businesses that are already there. We also have a lot of examples where companies apply that framework to generate totally new business. And I want to give you an example here, as we can build upon the example that we already had. When you look at this catheter manufacturer, this producer of these needles, their core business is producing these catheters. But if you reframe the business, if you reframe the core business and would say that the business is they are in is administering medication, and they should come up in a long-term vision with a single platform, solution platform that gets that whole job done, this would impact a lot of radical innovation with such a solution provider. Because when you consider administering medication, you need to know what medication to administer. You need to know how much medication to administer. You need to be able to monitor the whole administration process. And you need to troubleshoot if the administration does not work as it should. So there's a lot of stuff coming in that you simply cannot address with a needle or a catheter. And this will generate, on the product side, totally new products, totally new services. You may come up with a digital platform to support administering medications. You can think about doing this also in a remote basis to help patients in their homes to administer medications. So a lot of stuff comes in when you start to just reframe your existing business around a job to be done. And therefore, the application is, on the one hand, for the product manager, they will see a lot of potential for probably improving their existing needle and product. But on the other hand, you always want to have your strategy team, your business development team in such a project, because they will find radical areas for totally new products and services that are linked, directly linked to the core business from the viewpoint of the customer. And this will then also generate or improve likelihood of success of such radical innovations. And we could even go further and say, okay, what about totally different jobs? Another interesting point, and I'm happy to share examples on this as well. Let us do this in the next format, in the masterclasses then. Yeah, I see other statements here, just read through here. Yeah, because startups often really focus on their product and features, I think they often miss the link to the customers. Yeah, I would not put such a bold statement in here. I also have thought about startups and how startups could work with that way of thinking. And I think there are two types of startups. One type of startup is funded or founded by people who are really technical solution experts. And they have certain technologies in mind and they want to bring that to market and create value with it. And probably they have not such a link to the customers and the customer needs. So that's the one type of startup probably. But then you also have another type of startup where you have a user, somebody who has, you know, who has to administer a medication on their own every day and same time has technological competency. And these types of startups are typically pretty much linked to the customer needs as they know the needs from inside, as they are users themselves. And this is always the first question that I bring in when we talk to startups, how they are set up in this. And that would be my recommendation to integrate whatever it takes to integrate really users, real users in a startup operation, no matter what methodology you will use for that. Great, great point for discussion. I like it. Now, another question here. Do you have practical experience in using job-to-be-done approach in technology scouting and assessment? Yes, we have. There is an example that I could share as well. We had a chemical company, and we know a chemical company that have came up with a new process, a new process to create the chemicals. And it's a technological solution that changes the way you create a certain chemical. And the question was, should this company invest into that technology and do a merger and acquire that that technology or not? And we did an assessment of the customer needs of the customers that should use that technology by looking at the process, at the production process from a customer's point of view. And then we do the, then you can do a solution mapping and map all the features and benefits of a technology or of a solution that you have given against the real opportunities in the market. And then you can see if and how well this technology or product or solution really addresses the important opportunities that are there in the market. And so this can support such a technology assessment. Now, another question I see here, reducing experiments means reducing learning opportunities. Does it limit our company opportunity growth? That's a good point. Yes, please don't get me wrong. Experiments are a great thing to learn and also to better understand opportunities. But let me reframe this a little bit. If you get back to the example of administering medication getting a venous access, the outcome statements that are how they measure if they can get the job done right or not, and in what area of the job step, they are challenged. The experiments you will need to have then to really test out what would be the best solution to it. And you will probably have 2, 3, 4, 5 alternative approaches to address accessing a vein. And this is then an activity down the line when you are in the design process that you test out and do experiments with different designs. What I meant before with you will be faster with doing that is you will already know in what areas you should do such experiments as those areas that deliver the highest opportunities for innovation from the customer's point of view. So it's not a yes or no. It's a yes and. You need to do experiments, of course, and design, of course, as well. It does not change that. Now, another question: new solutions change the future structure of jobs to be done. Do you have any examples on that? Yeah, that's also very good. I see you are really experienced innovators here in that webinar. So new solutions may change the future structure of a job to be done. We can come up with a lot of examples on this. An example would be that when you look at the software development and development of the internet and the cloud business possibilities that we have based on internet technology today, they have generated a lot of jobs to be done that have not been there before the technology was there. So there is a new job of software security that came up when the cloud business really took off. There are new jobs around implementing software in a business that was not there before software was there. There are new jobs in learning how to use software in a proper way that have not been there. You know, there were no PowerPoint trainings before PowerPoint was there. So a lot of jobs will come up in the future together with new technologies. Our take on that, or a potential approach to this situation, is that you want to first of all focus on the jobs that you actually serving. So the manufacturer of that catheters, of that needles, may go a little bit higher in their job definition. So not to say I'm providing a solution for accessing a vein, because that's the catheter, but go to a higher level of a job definition, like it's about administering medication. And you can be pretty sure that administering medication will be there also in the future. And most probably you will have totally different technologies, and different technologies will probably also lead to additional jobs that people will have. But the core of it, administering medication, will most probably be there also for a long period of time in the future. So how to address this, this situation that jobs will change? The higher you go, the lower the speed of change is of a job to be done. The lower you are in your job definition, the closer you are on the existing product or solution, on the function of the existing product, the more likely is that probably the job will be gone as once the technology is gone. Okay. Yeah, thanks. You have really great questions. I would definitely, I would love to really discuss it. And here we have in the webinar format, you know, just a kind of chat and my talking then on this. It was a pleasure for me having you there in the webinar. I would be very happy to keep on that dialogue with whatever kind of channels, give me an email, LinkedIn, or WhatsApp or whatsoever. Let us team up again, maybe in the next webinar or in the masterclass in September or the advanced one with Roche in October. There's also an innovators talk that I moderate. It will take place in the first week of September, I think September 4. You will find this on the website. And thank you very much. And thank you also for your great comments and great questions. I wish you good successes in finding those quick wins and generating short-term results in your teams for your organizations. And please stay connected and stay healthy. Thank you. Goodbye.